In this episode of the Locked On NBA Big Board podcast, me and my guy Richard Stayman, Mr. Mavs Draft, we are going to tackle the big discussion in the NBA draft world over the last, I would say, 24 hours. It is Brandon Miller or Scoot Henderson. I know who I'm going with. I have an idea who Richard's going with, but stay tuned to hear our arguments. This episode is brought to you by the Ultimate Basketball GM. Ever dreamed of becoming an NBA GM? No, I have. And managing your own basketball franchise? Then this is definitely for you. To download the game, just visit ultimatebasketballgm.com or look it up on the app stores. Our listeners, if you are a big board listener, you get up to a, or you get a 100% free boost to your franchise when you're using the promo code Locked On. And it has to be all caps, L-O-C-K-E-D-O-N, all caps. All right, hopefully everybody is having a great start to their week. This is a big week in the basketball world with the NCAA tournament starting. But we got a little bit of a bombshell, at least for me, it wasn't. A little bit of a bombshell when you started seeing rumblings about Brandon Miller possibly passing Scoot Henderson. I received a tweet that I guess John Hollinger had mentioned something in a similar fashion. I know David Thorpe from True Hoop is a basketball mind I really respect. He made a similar comment. And then I guess on ESPN, which a lot of people consider to be the top platform when it comes to covering the draft, they had a comment about it really being a discussion that Scoot is not a lock. I think The Ringer did the same. And then even Sam Vecenie from The Athletic mentioned that it is a real discussion that Brandon Miller could pass Scoot Henderson for the number two pick. But before we get into that, I didn't even ask you how you're doing. Like, how was your day? Like, how are you preparing for March Madness and all this news that's been out over the last few hours?
Yeah, 24 hours. Yeah, there's a few things. So one, I'm a massive overthinker, so this is like peak my season where I overthink everything and get no results from it with March Madness. But also, I think we're forgetting, you know, I haven't seen this question posed. I tweeted something about it on Tuesday saying like that this guy could benefit, and that's Tyrese Proctor. He's somebody who I think could benefit from a strong March. Nobody's been talking about like the fact if I feel like we're so used to it that we don't talk about it anymore, which is GMs are going to be seeing March Madness. They're going to be seeing college players for the first times of all season. I mean, there's been a few I know that were at conference tournaments, but like this is the time where they start watching college basketball. We haven't talked about who stock could get hit the most, I think, outside of podcast, but I haven't even seen a tweet about it like anywhere. It feels like where it's like not even the low-hanging fruit. So it's really interesting. Maybe we're just used to it and expect it, and we're like, it's fine. Kind of like a Mo Wagner. I know there's a couple guys recently, Dante DiVincenzo, other guys, but obviously that's not actually what we're here to talk about. But that is just what's been on my mind.
Yeah, I just posted a tweet about Oso Iguodaro. He's the guy that I think is going to benefit from, you know, the NCAA platform and the opportunity to play in front of scouts. And this is kind of like a perfect segue into this entire conversation. So the news came out today that Scoot Henderson has shut it down for the season. I was actually at the Texas Legends game on Sunday expecting to see him play. He didn't play. I ran into a couple of friends. They left at halftime, and it was the second time in Texas, at least in the Dallas area, to play the Legends that he didn't play. It was, for me, my fourth or fifth time trying to watch him live, and I've only been able to catch him one game, and then I guess a game and some change, and I was in Las Vegas when he played against Wembanyama. So, first of all, let's talk about him deciding to shut it down. What are your thoughts on that? I know I have my opinion on it, but what are your thoughts on that?
There's only a few games left in the season, so that was pretty much the logic behind it was, hey, let's not, like, the G League Ignite's whole purpose isn't to be winning G League titles. It's quite literally to be developing draft prospects and to revive some careers that aren't for, like, the for the players that are not draft prospects. So the G League Ignite, they're not making the playoffs in the G League. There's really not a lot to play for. Why hurt Scoot's stock? Now, that being said, kind of right now, as we just talked about, I mean, there's a lot of people who think that Scoot Henderson's stock is actually falling. So I think almost not playing is, in a way, you know, before private workouts, which are 2 months away from now, what's he going to be doing while Brandon Miller is on the biggest stage in basketball right now? I actually don't know if I necessarily agree. You know, would I be on him at the moment? Probably not. But what if he ended the season the way he just ended his last game with, I think it was like 15, 12, and 7 with a steal and a block? What if he was averaging that, like 15, 9, 10, whatever, with 5 rebounds and a block and a steal for the final 4 or 5 games, whatever it is? That would have meant a lot, I think, because he had battled through injuries for a lot of the first, honestly, all year. He's been up and down. I think it's hard to find a long stretch of him playing. He only played 27 games, if I'm not mistaken. So for me, I have feelings on both. I get it, why they shut him down, but also what's there to gain by shutting him down at this point while his stock is falling.
Well, here's the thing. Like, I've worked in the G League, and I'm very familiar with how the G League is at this time of year. It is, and I don't want to knock the G League. I mean, I got my start in the G League. It's honestly bad basketball. At this point, guys understand, like, I'm not getting a call up. People, some guys are disappointed that they've spent the entire season there. They came into the season with the mindset of, I'm going to come in here, get a call up. The numbers that you see guys posting late in the G League season, you got to take them with a grain of salt, which is very similar to the NBA. You start seeing guys put up these huge numbers late. I give you an example. The Texas Legends called up Jacob Young. I get him confused. Jacob Young. He hadn't played. He was in Houston. Drove 4 hours. First game, 21-6-6. Just fresh off of riding up I-45. And then they released him, and now he's playing with the main Red Claws. So you see guys coming off the street putting up those type of numbers. So when you see that, and a guy that people are saying is a generational talent, 15 points, 14 points, those aren't like really, really big numbers. He had I want to say his first 5 games, maybe his first 5 games, he had over 25 points or more in 4 of his first 5 games. After February 1st, he had 1 game above 18 points. So some people feel like he may have been mailed it in. Some think it was the injuries. The injuries were, I want to say maybe it was an ankle injury, but it was like a nasal fracture, concussion, and so on. And the hard part about the G League and even maybe overtime elite is you're not facing the same pressured situations as you face in college basketball. College basketball, you want to win your regular season conference title. Even if your team can't win the regular season conference title, there's an incentive to go out and play hard to win the conference tournament title. And then there's an NCAA tournament. So there's nobody really like cruising or coasting or shutting it down. I mean, they didn't do it in overtime elite. They ended up winning the title, talking about the Thompson twins. But with all that being said, I think it's kind of put a little bitter taste in some people's mouths that Scoot has decided to shut it down when Wembanyama, who's going to go number one regardless, has continued to play, has even played in the world qualifiers in the middle of his season. He even came to the United States to play in a scrimmage game that didn't mean anything during his season. And I know for a fact that people have been telling Vic to shut it down, and he hasn't shut it down. So I think that's going to leave a bitter taste in some people's mouth. At the end of the day, I mean, Scoot is going to go top 3 regardless. So when we return, we'll go a little bit deeper into like why you think Brandon Miller is even in the discussion, because a couple of months ago it was, I mean, I got totally blasted on social media for even bringing it up. We'll talk about that when we return, but let's talk about the ultimate GM. Now, I've had like people tell me all about it. I haven't downloaded the game yet, but from what I've been hearing, it is totally fun. And if you've ever dreamed about being an NBA GM and managing your own basketball franchise, your dream can come true with this game. You are in charge of hiring the coaches and the assistants. You can trade players. You're in charge of the development, making draft picks, and you navigate your franchise through free agency and the draft and all the ups and downs. And it is very challenging and realistic. And what makes it so fun is that it is completely free. Well, I mean, it would be fun if you pay for it, but it's completely free. You can play it offline, online, and you can play it when you want. And Locked On, if you're a Locked On listener, you get a 100% free boost to your franchise when you use the promo code Locked On in the game store. So download the game. Just visit probasketballgm.com, scan the code, or look it up in the app stores. That is probasketballgm.com. It's the ultimate basketball GM, so start your dynasty today. All right, second segment. So we talked about, I mean, it just seems like time is going by fast. We talked about Scoot shutting it down, and you mentioned your understanding behind it. And I see two sides. I see if I'm an agent, I'm representing him. Hey, you don't want to get hurt. Someone told me, I didn't watch the game, but I spoke to a front office executive, and he mentioned there was a play in the game in Atlanta where he went up for a dunk, and I guess he got fouled or kind of basically it was a risky play. And he believes that was the play where you're like, okay, you know what, just shut it down. So I get it from the agency standpoint. You want to protect your guy from injury, not necessarily his draft stock, but his injury in meaningless games. If you're a GM, how much stock would you put into that?
Into just the fact that he shut it down?
Yeah, because, you know, like, let's just keep it 100% real. Fans are complaining about guys not playing, guys that are healthy, that are sitting out. I mean, you got load management. I saw some people talking about how is their load management in the G League? How is a G League player tanking to go to another team that's tanking? So there's a fan perspective, but you're in charge. You're the GM, whatever. What is your thought about that? Do you just say, you know, he's making the smart move, or do you say, hey, I don't know if I like this decision?
I see it both ways. I think on one hand, yeah, it's the modern NBA. I don't think I read into it too much on that. But like you said, Victor Wembanyama is not packing it in. He's more of a lock at his position than Scoot Henderson is. So what's the rationale there? I've also, and I think it wouldn't be an issue. There's one thing that bothers me, and I want to emphasize this. You know this. The G League doesn't play much defense. So, like, I'm reading into something that there's not much on here. But Scoot doesn't – I don't think he has tried that hard for a lot of this season. It's been inconsistent effort. When he wants to be good, he can be good on defense. But so often I see him out of stance. He's hunched over. He's standing upright even against like Tremont Waters ISO'd him, and he just didn't care, you know? And it's things like that where, you know, that combination may make you look into saying, you know, asking him certain questions in that pre-draft process to make sure, like, I don't think there's a motor issue, but it's probably just, again, the G League is that way. He fought through injuries. I'm very willing to give that the benefit of the doubt. But it kind of makes you look into, hey, what's the motor like? Because that's something we just haven't talked about with Scoot. Again, I think his motor is fine, but it is something that may raise some flags at the end of the day.
Yeah, and I'm high on Scoot. And I have Brandon Miller number two. And it's definitely not a knock on Scoot. The question I have is, did we, and I'm saying we as the media, play a role in crowning him too fast? Coming into the season, everyone said, oh, he's, you know, he's number two. It's a lock. It's a two-player draft. Brandon Miller was, I think, the ninth rated player on ESPN. I did plenty of articles and interviews on him with different scouts. He was the most divisive prospect coming into this season, at least based off the people I talked to. There was one guy, well, I won't mention his name. There was one guy that had Brandon Miller number two early in the season. He had him number two really early. And then there was another guy that I talked to that had him going in the 20s. A lot of concerns there, right? So Miller had something to prove all season long. He had to prove that he was the best player in college basketball. He had to prove that it's not a two-player draft. Well, what did Scoot really have to prove? And to me, if you say that his motor was a little inconsistent, that could be a part of it. We crowned him.
Yeah.
We crowned him. But then on the other side, Vic has been crowned for years and he's coming out, he's competing. I do think the biggest difference is if you win a G League title, nobody cares. It's almost like winning a Summer League title. But for Wembanyama, he is playing because if you win the French title, it means something. You know, you win the title in your domestic league. There's so much more behind it for Wembanyama. So with that being said, how do you evaluate the G League in competitive games? We know the talent is there, but in real competitive pressured environments, they won't have any.
Yeah, I think it's one of the most subjective, like everything in evaluation is subjective, but I think the G League especially is that one, the access isn't so great. I think it's a little bit hard to watch. Granted, ESPN has made it a lot easier. Most games are available on demand within 30 days of the air date. So that's really good. But the G League's hard. Nobody, I mean, again, you know, this defense is optional. It's gotten a little bit better, but there's really not such of a thing as defensive schemes on the defensive end in the G League. It's a very different game than college, than the NBA, and then Europe. Like it is just vastly unique for pros and cons. And I think kind of like you said, like the motor probably is because I think I agree with you. Like we have talked about this kid as, he's number two, next one. And there's no such thing as a lock in the NBA draft. Apparently there is for Wembanyama. I think he's debunked that one. But for most players, there's no such thing as a lock. And it's just hard with Scoot. Like, where do you go? Because I don't think any two people are starting to shape up and have similar evaluation anymore. Get a little bit more polarizing on him where, I mean, I've seen people who are not NBA draft people who have watched, you know, highlights one game, whatever it is, and say, I don't know, I don't get the appeal. And that kind of means something, I think.
Which is incredible because just in January, I got crucified. I was literally tweeting and arguing with people over 24 hours. I remember, I think I made the comment, this is when people didn't have him in their top five. I said, I'm moving him to number three. And then I said, and then it was Tyrese Rice. Shout out to Tyrese Rice. The guy that had a great career in Europe. He mentioned Miller could go as high as number two. And I replied that if I'm Detroit, there's no way that I'm taking Scoot Henderson or something along those lines. I'm taking Brandon Miller. So then all of a sudden it was like late at night. I woke up. I mean, hundreds of mentions. I saw he's stupid. I saw dudes giving me statistical breakdowns. I saw one guy was like, he is the worst finisher since Zaire Williams. And Zaire Williams was playing on one leg. I mean, it was just all this stuff. But now all of a sudden, people are starting to change their thoughts. And Brandon Miller has pretty much played the exact same way, except he's finishing better at the rim. And one of the things everyone used was, well, against North Carolina, he couldn't score against Leaky Black, so on and so on. Do you think that Draft Twitter, let's just talk about Draft Twitter. Do you think Draft Twitter is convinced? Are they still going to stick to their opinions and hold it down that Scoot is by far head and shoulders above any other prospect in college basketball or outside of Wembanyama?
Look, I love Draft Twitter. And so I say this in a very passionate, or I'm blanking on the right word, but you know, I mean this in a positive way. I'm not trying to roast people and say, oh, damn you kids and your opinions or something. But, you know, Draft Twitter is very much known from both within Draft Twitter and from NBA Twitter for not changing and adjusting to the realities because the preconceived notion. It's a walking confirmation bias. We all have done it. I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm very far from it. I've made some stupid takes. But to answer your question, no, Draft Twitter is not going to change their guns. I'm a prime example. I'm still keeping Scoot at two. Spoiler alert. But I want to read the tweet that you put out that got you absolutely killed. And somebody asked, he said, I don't care what the media says. I just want to know what you think makes him a top five guy outside of the shooting. And I think you nailed it. Like I've read this thread. I've been reading it while you were talking. And as you said, and I was like, did somebody really say that? And they did. And you said, well, he's a 6'9" skilled shooter that can knock down jumpers off the catch or off the dribble. At the time, this is mid-January, so conference play had only just begun, but he was shooting 72% on unguarded catch and shoot shot attempts. And also, that was a time where he probably already had over 50 catch and shoot shots. Like, that was a real-ish sample size. Like, that's a normal number in college, even now, for some guys. He's skinny, but he's grabbing 8 rebounds a game, and he has more in his bag than he's been able to show. He's a 3-level scorer once he had strength. And, dude, I think you've nailed it. Like, everything you said has aged beautifully. He's grown into his game, and he's very far from his upside. I know the original argument was he probably tops out as a 3rd or 4th option on a team. And I think that's so far from the truth. I think you hit everything on the head. If you go back and look at that thread, you'll find Rafael just nailed it.
Well, I don't want to make this a Rafael victory lap because we still have plenty of time left. But the whole subject is the gap is closing. I mean, he was generational, like untouchable as far as any other prospect. And now the gap has somewhat seemed to close. All right, when we return, we'll talk about why you still have him at number 2 and why you still think that Brandon Miller is, I don't even know where you have Miller on your board, but we'll talk about that when we return. But let's talk about FanDuel. And we are almost at the end of the NBA season, and it's still the perfect time to download FanDuel, which is America's number one sports book. And because now, if you're a new customer, you get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. That's bonus bets back. If your first bet doesn't win, just download FanDuel Sportsbook app. It is safe, it is secure, and it is easy to use. Then you can bet on everything from the money line to points scored and threes drained. That's tough to say. Plus, FanDuel even lets you combine your bets for a chance at a bigger payout with a same game parlay. So do not miss your chance to get your no sweat first bet up to $1,000 in bonus bets when you go to FanDuel.com/lockedon. That is FanDuel.com/lockedon. Make every moment more with FanDuel, an official sports betting partner of the NBA. All right, last segment. So you have not budged, which is totally fine. I mean, I respect everybody's opinion, right? And that's one of the things about draft Twitter that can get a little icky at times, is that some people are super adamant and want to argue you down just because you have a difference of opinion. None of us have been 100% right. I mean, even the guys that are paid millions of dollars. And the thing that a lot of people don't take into account is sometimes when guys don't succeed or live up to the expectations, it has absolutely nothing to do with talent. It may not even have anything to do with fit. We're talking about 18, 19 years old, guaranteed millions of dollars in the bank, and you have to have a certain level of maturity to handle all the money and free time. And if you're just motivated by getting to the league, then you're probably not going to be successful. And that's the thing that you, as a fan, you really don't have any idea. So anyway, Scoot is number 2. Now, do you still, or did you say he was generational? Did you feel he was a generational talent?
I still think he's at a minimum at the wall of being there. Because you just look at the combination of size, athleticism, and finishing ability, it really does scream like the names that you start to compare him to, the names that you start thinking of, I would say, are generational players, or at least generational prospects. I would say the number one player people always think of is the youngest MVP ever, Derrick Rose. Just the way he gets to the rim, finishes at the rim. I don't think it's one-to-one, but there's a lot of similarities. And then also another name I've heard as a mix, like the best one I've heard of as why he's seen generational, is he's a blend of, you know, I don't know how accurate it is, but the fact that these two players are being thrown in, or you throw in some of John Wall, you throw in some of Derrick Rose into his game. And, you know, that's a pretty special player. It's not a perfect comparison, but when you have shades of those players, and I think a lot of people forget John Wall was an outstanding pre-draft prospect and an awesome player. I think that's why he's deemed generational.
All right, I'm going to give you this comparison I heard, and I talked about it online, offline to you. This is, and I've been holding this for a while. I got to find a message. I've been holding this for a while because I didn't want it to be clickbaitish. I didn't want it to be, you know what I mean? Like, I was trying to make a name for myself by saying this out loud. So this is a tweet from a very well-respected talent evaluator. November 12th, he says, I don't know if I'm rolling with Scoot as a top two guy. So I reply, who do you have over him? Are you swinging for Amon Thompson? He says, yes, as of now, I haven't studied the guys like that yet, but Amon screams upside. Are you ready for this? He says, Scoot is Eric Bledsoe. He's better than that, but I don't know about top two. I take Jaden Ivey over him every day of the week. This is on November 12th.
Man, now I'm curious who said this, but I'm probably going towards the wrong things.
Hold on, but here's another thing about this person that said this. He told me in 2018, Gilgeous Alexander was going to be better than Trae Young. Now, he told me if he were the general manager of the team, he said he probably would have got fired after Trae went to the conference finals. But he was like, the owner long-term, if the owner had a long-term picture, he probably would still have his job. But now, again, when I say this is someone that I respect, he told me this in 2018, that he would take SGA over Trae. And this is SGA when he had the shackles on him at Kentucky, when he wasn't loose. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, and you said Bledsoe was him?
He said Eric Bledsoe. I'm going to read it again, just in case. I had to make sure. Again, November 12th, 10:36 p.m. I don't know if I'm rolling with Scoot as a top two guy. Scoot is Eric Bledsoe. But he says he's better than that, but I don't know about top two. I take Ivy over him every day of the week.
I don't see. Okay, so here's my thing. I think people forget this one thing about Eric Bledsoe. If you gave him, like, let's just think about the blunders he has had. I don't know if you guys remember against the Celtics, I think it was 2018, where he made one of the most boneheaded decisions and he lost them a game. Like, this guy never has had a crazy feel for the game, and he still averaged, I'm looking at his peak, I would say somewhere, it was 18 and a half points a game, 6 assists, 5 rebounds on 45.5% shooting, 34% from 3, 80% from the line. So for me, and he was a great defender. I mean, he was an all defense guy. I think if you gave him a much better feel for the game, we're looking at a vastly different player. So to me, I don't see it as a knock. I honestly think it just shows how much better Eric Bledsoe could have been. I think Scoot Henderson is, they are similar, but I think a big thing also is just when they're coming in the league. If I'm not mistaken, Eric Bledsoe was a sophomore. Scoot Henderson is worlds.
He's a freshman.
Yeah. It's still, though, like, he was worlds better at equal ages, just even before college, like before Eric Bledsoe's first year. Scoot Henderson was better at 17 than Bledsoe was at 18. So, like, there's a big difference there, and I do think that stuff matters. So that combination of early advancement plus way better feel makes Scoot a much better player. And so, like, I think it's actually not as much of a knock as it's meant to be. I actually think it's a pretty good thing.
Okay, yeah, because Bledsoe's best year was about 21 points, 6 assists, 5 boards, 43% from the floor, 33% from 3.
While playing good D.
Which, you know, again, it's people only want to compare guys to, like, the sexiest names and all that. And then, of course, I get it if you say, well, I'm not taking Eric Bledsoe number 2 if that's your comparison. But it was funny because, again, I hadn't tweeted it out. And I finally decided to debut it now, but I haven't talked to him yet. And I'm sure I'll probably talk to him within the next couple of days as he'll give me a breakdown. Because, again, this was early. This was very early in the season when, let me look it up, November 12th, Scoot, that same day. Okay, so you know what? He texted me after the, I'm looking it up. November 12th, Scoot had 18 points, 16 assists, 6 rebounds on 8 of 19 shooting. And this, I was texted by Eric Bledsoe right after he had, on paper, a really good game. So this guy wasn't even impressed with one of the better games on paper in Scoot's season. Now, Brandon Miller, like, where do you have him on your board?
I have him 3. I mean, they're back-to-back.
Is there, like, has he moved up, or are you someone that over time you needed to be sold on him? Which, you know, I mean, that's what happens during the whole season.
I saw that play on words. I had Amon Thompson, who's with Overtime Elite. So well done on that setup of a pun. But I had Amon Thompson. For me, it's just, I mean, let's take a look at what Brandon Miller has done over the last month. I mean, he had a 41-point game, granted, it was against South Carolina. Like, let's tone down on that.
But 41 but in college basketball is
it doesn't exactly crazy. If it was so easy, everybody would have done it. And the SEC is a pretty dang good conference, and nobody did it. So I think it says something. And yeah, there's been some inconsistencies throughout March. I think it's honestly a little bit of fatigue in the way of just, or not really like fatigue physically, but just the mental fatigue of, all right, I know we're the one seed, we're the best team in the country. Does he need to, like, he just kind of changed his play style, I think, a little bit in March Madness. And also his shots just weren't falling. It was a little, it was actually really unlucky shots, I would say. I want to overthink this so badly. I started this episode by saying I'm an overthinker. Last year, I dropped Paolo from one because his February was brutal. He shot under 40% as a 6'11", 6'10" guy, and I penalized for him. Granted, he made it up for it in March, and I just still thought that February was more important than March for whatever stupid reason. I'm not going to do that again. So that's why I have Brandon Miller up to three.
You know, it's funny. You talk about the overthinking, and I remember going back to 2018. That was the issue with Luka. He had this stretch where he just wasn't playing as well. And to put it into context, and I probably know this a little bit better than others because I was over there at the time. His team went all the way to the Final Four, which in the Final Four, it's in May. But then the Spanish ACB Championship goes into, I want to say, June. Had a short summer, played for the national team, went to Eurobasket, led Slovenia to Eurobasket. That is in August. And then while I was in Istanbul for Eurobasket, the teams in Europe had already started training camp. He went straight from Eurobasket into the season. So he literally played nonstop, two or three games a week from August until, honestly, June, because he just won the ACB championship and then flew to the draft. I mean, it was probably like a couple days difference. So he did have a point in the season where he hit a wall. And people were saying he looks slow, he looks tired, yada, yada, yada. Well, I don't know if that was the reason why the Kings didn't draft him, and we heard why the Suns didn't draft him. But there were people that were off of him because they watched him at that point, and that was when he was probably at his peak, when the hype was just really, really, you know what I mean, like starting to circulate, and then people would watch him. And basically they were just like, oh, I don't see it. And it was because they judged that small window. And like a really long, it was almost like a 10-month stretch, but he did have like a 1 or 1.5 month stretch where he just wasn't as dominant. So that can totally happen. Do you think that there's a chance that Miller could fall past three? Because the Thompson twins are done playing. Their season is over. Depending on workouts, you know, I mean, unless, I don't even know, like if they have like a great shooting workout, does that bump them up for you at all? Like if you see videos about them knocking down open shots, can that move them up?
I wouldn't even say the videos would do it for me. It would have to be like real sources came out and said, hey, like he's been shooting well in workouts. And things that aren't smoke too, like it's somewhere in that fine line, right? Where it's something where, say, Woj or Javoni, one of them said like, hey, he's shooting really well at workouts. Like we've been hearing that. That would intrigue me. I think he's the only player, Amen Thompson is the only player that could unseat Brandon Miller at three right now. Like just going down the board, Cam Whitmore's not going to do it. I don't think All-Star Thompson's going to do it. And then after that, it's like there's a big drop off. So I think Brandon Miller's locked in the top four.
For me, I'd have to see it. I wouldn't just go by tweets. I mean, it's not a secret that Woj and Gavoni have different relationships with different agents. I mean, that's just how the game works, right? And so just like no difference between me and you. If
politics,
there's a guy that and I don't even want to like make it just all about politics, but if you know someone says, hey, you know, such and such is shooting well, and they send us clips, and we just report it, then that's just what we report it. That doesn't necessarily mean it's the gospel. Like, for me, I'd have to, like, see it, right? But even then, I saw Dyson Daniels at the combine. I thought he shot it well, but he, like, skyrocketed, like, into the lottery because he shot it well. in an empty, it wasn't empty, it was scouts there, and it is difficult to play, you know, just shoot by yourself in front of a bunch of scouts. I mean, 100, 200 scouts watching. So there's a little bit of pressure there. You got to be in good shape. But I wonder if Amin or Asar have a pro day where they, you know, shoot 8 out of 10 from the corner, 8 out of 10 from the top, 7 out of 10 from the wings, and it's recorded. Could they possibly, you know, bypass Brandon Miller or maybe even Scoot Henderson? I don't know, but I don't think it's totally out of the question.
I think it's fair. I think Brandon Miller and Scooter, I think the four guys have solidified themselves, right? Wembanyama, Scoot, Miller, and Amin. I think that's a solidified top four at this point, though. At this moment, it could change. But
all right, last question. Who's your number five?
God, I mean, by the time this comes out, my answer's probably changed. I have Cam Whitmore. I really like his tools, just athleticism, size, shooting. I think, and he plays defense. Like, that's just a modern wing. So for me, it has the star upside. Can he work for it? It's up to him. Like you said, talent isn't the only way NBA draft, you know, guys hitting through the draft. So will he work for it? It's up to him.
Yeah. As of now, I have him at number nine. For my number five, I think Nick Smith has a chance with a strong tournament run. He has a chance. Well, that wraps up this episode of the Locked On NBA Big Board podcast. For your next listen, you have to check out the Game to Game podcast. Locked On Game to Game is it's on the NBA, Locked On NBA channel. It gives you analysis that only Locked On can deliver. So check out the Locked On NBA Game to Game podcast.